Okay, so a couple of weeks back, I recorded a video about Hugging Face releasing a model called Zephyr 7B Alpha. And I mentioned at the time that
their plan
was to do a sort of series of models and that
the Alpha
was the first
model.
So they've just released the beta model or the second model in this. And it's kind of interesting to look at and see, okay, what have they changed? They've given some nice information in about how they did the training, how they did the alignment, etc. And one of my complaints last time was that they hadn't released just the pure SFT version or the supervised fine-tuning version. They only released the version that was fully aligned. So what they've done with this one is they've actually released both the supervised fine-tuned version and the actual DPO fully aligned direct preference optimization version in here. So I'll walk through the results of running the code in a bit. I just want to go quickly through some of the changes that they've made and some of the things that they've talked about. So one of the things that's really interesting is they've actually released a technical report now. And it's kind of interesting that the technical report seems to mention a lot more than what they had talked about before of this being a direct distillation from another large language model. They've got this nice diagram in their report that basically goes through some of the abilities of the model and how it compares to GPT 3.5 Turbo, GPT-4, etc. And we can see that it's quite good with certain things and probably still quite lacking, even behind GPT 3.5, for things like math and coding and extraction tasks, etc. And certainly a long way behind GPT-4 for those kind of tasks in here. So the main benchmark that they've gone for in here is the MT Bench benchmark. And the idea here is that this is a multi-turn dialogue, and this is where they claim that they can beat models of up to 10 times bigger than the 7 billion model that they've trained themselves in here. The other benchmark that they seem to have used a lot also is this AlpacaEval leaderboard. And again, they're comparing against models that are much, much bigger than this fine tune, which is only 7 billion parameters in here. So what did they actually change in doing the beta version of the model compared to the alpha version of the model? So one of the key things that they mention is basically just filtering the data set. So they mention that they used UltraChat. And I think I mentioned in the previous video that that's a very big data set in the hundreds of thousands or more. And they basically filtered that down to sort of 200,000 examples. But then they noticed a number of things that they've pointed out in relation to some of the flaws that they found the model sort of having. And those two flaws sort of included things like writing incorrect casing, and also the whole sort of, I don't have a personal opinion, you know, that kind of thing, which comes a lot from the distillation of the GPT OpenAI models. We've seen that many times. So by filtering that out, they've been able to get a much better supervised fine-tuning model to use as a base model. The next key difference is that they basically seem to have noticed that if they overfit on this DPO process, that they can actually get much better at the chat benchmarks. This is kind of an interesting idea. The thing that I wonder, though, are the benchmarks the thing that we should be going for all the time? And in some ways, maybe they are for this. You know, I'm not sure. I guess it really is going to depend on your particular use case. I'll show you sort of one example where, for me, the SFT model actually does better than the DPO aligned model later on. And that could be due to the overfitting. I'm not 100% sure. I need to look into it a lot more before I'd come to that as an absolute conclusion. So they do examine whether the SFT and the DPO are really needed here. And I think this is definitely an interesting area of research. So not surprisingly, I think they, you know, sort of say, well, applying just DPO without SFT is not going to be so good. We kind of know that the SFT or the instruction fine tuning is definitely key to getting these models to do the things that we want them to do. They also sort of looked at doing a supervised fine tuning and including the best response from the ultra feedback, which is what they use for doing the direct preference optimization, also didn't seem to give as good a result. That's definitely something that I think is an interesting observation. And I'm curious to see, like, if that holds true for other things going forward. Not surprisingly, they come to the conclusion that for what they were doing, applying both the supervised fine-tuning and the direct preference optimization gave the best performance in here for this. So we can see that, from the technical report in here, we've got this nice ablation study of trying these different things out. Although it's interesting to see just the standard supervised fine-tuning seems to get, scores that are reasonably close to using the DPO plus SFT in there. So let's jump in and have a look at the actual how the model performs and stuff like that. All right, so I'm basically just loading up the model in here, and I'm using the exact same notebook that I did for the alpha. I'm just swapping the models out. So it actually makes it quite easy for us to check and see how it went with the exact same system prompt and the exact same instruction prompt in here. So we can see that when we ask it, the sort of questions, we're getting similar answers for a lot of these things. It's interesting to note that, like, as I've sort of used more of these fine tunings of Mistral, one of the key things that I notice is that a lot of the sort of structure really is coming from the Mistral model, not just the fine tunes. So this is one of the things that originally that I thought the Mistral Orca was really good at, sort of breaking these things down and step by step, and it certainly is. But a lot of that I noticed was coming also in other fine tunes of Mistral that weren't using the same data set as that. So we can see that here quite nicely when we look at this sort of question, the standard question about what's the difference between llamas, vicunas, and an alpaca. It likes to break things down and give you answers for this. When we ask it, okay, write the sort of email to Sam Altman, again, it breaks it down into these sort of steps in here. Now, where I thought this one did quite nicely is it's adopting the system prompt where I give it the exact same instruction prompt about the email, but I give it multiple system prompts where, okay, one is for a 5-year-old boy, one is just for the standard helpful assistant, and then the last one is, you are Kate, the Vice President of the United States. And we can see that this does really adopt the personality in here. And this is one of the areas that I think is kind of interesting when we compare it to the supervised fine-tuning. So I'll come back to this concept. A lot of the other ones, quite standard stuff. Again, we see, like with the Geoffrey Hinton, even though we're asking it to do it step by step, it really goes through sort of how to do this. And then comes up that while this is an intriguing thought experiment, it's not possible because of the fact that George Washington is no longer alive. It's done a nice job with that. It also does a nice job on this one, I think, perhaps a little bit better than the previous one with some of the creative writing tasks. So I think that one's kind of interesting. Okay, so the code gen ones, it seems to be sort of on par with the previous one. Lastly, let's look at the GSM 8K in here. And we can see that it does a good job of working out that this is, that we had 9 apples left for that one. It doesn't do a good job with the babysitting part here. We can see that its logic is quite off in some parts here, where it goes from being $12 per hour to suddenly working out that 50 minutes is going to be $14 or something there. So that's one that doesn't do well. And then the other one, which is definitely the harder one, it doesn't do very well with this at all. And then if I just break that down into sort of a math thing, it really doesn't do that well at all with that. So let's look at the SFT version. So the SFT version obviously hasn't had the same alignment. I'm very curious to know whether this was actually trained with system messages or not. Because one of the things I find in it is if we look at the email to Sam Altman, we can see, clearly that, okay, it writes a nice email here. It hasn't gotten the step-by-step thing as much, which is interesting. But when we give it the system prompt of, you are Freddie, a 5-year-old boy, it really doesn't get that at all in here. It falls back to having like the steps and stuff like that, but there's no real sort of sense. And the same is true with the vice president one, that it doesn't seem to refer to it. Where you compare this one to the one that was done with the DPO, it really adopts the characters really nicely. So I'm curious to know if that's just the way they did the supervised fine-tuning, or is there something going on where the DPO is actually assisting in that really well? Another thing that I see with some of the questions on the SFT only version is it's much more to the point. So if we ask it, what is the capital of England? It just says London, right? It's not going to form nice answers as much. This is the same true, you know, is true with the sort of Geoffrey Hinton and George Washington question in here. And I encourage you to try these things out yourself. The other ones, though, that I did find really interesting are the GSM 8K ones. And in this case, it gets the 9 in apples correct. It gets much closer with the babysitting question. And its logic seems to be simpler in the way that it does it. So the sort of flaw that it's done here is that rather than be 0.83 and the 3 being recurring, it's just gone for 0.83, and therefore it's calculated that, which turns out to be 4 cents off the correct answer in there. So that one's kind of interesting. All right, if we give it the deep sea monster one, this is definitely one of the harder questions from GSM 8K. We can see that it doesn't do a good job there. But when I break it down so that it's like this, it actually gets the correct answer. So this is something that the DPO version didn't do. So it makes me wonder, by doing DPO in a certain way, are you actually sort of removing some of the ability for this to do reasoning tasks and things like that? I think this is definitely something that needs to be looked at. And perhaps, is there a form of DPO that you could do that would really hone the model in on understanding the difference between sort of creative writing tasks or instruction answering tasks and kind of logic tasks, which perhaps need to be answered in a different way for the actual alignment of those? So that's something that's definitely interesting to look at going through this. So anyway, I'll put both of these up and you can have a play with them yourself and try them out for your own tasks. I do think it's something that's really interesting to compare both the supervised fine-tuning versions of the model plus the direct preference optimization version of the model that has gone through both SFT and DPO to see, okay, where is it stronger? Where is it perhaps weaker for certain responses and for trying these things out? It's definitely an interesting area, and it's fantastic that they're actually releasing all this work. One of the nice things that they've released along with the data sets and the actual models for this is they've actually released the alignment handbook for this as well, of how they're actually doing this kind of stuff, their thinking, and they've gone and released a technical report as well. So check all those out. It's definitely an interesting model to look at and to see. And I'm wondering, okay, you know, if we're going to get a third model in the series, are we going to get something even newer than this to see, okay, how that goes as well? Anyway, as always, if you've got questions, please put them in the comments below. If you found the video useful, please give it a like. I'll talk to you in the next video. Bye for now.